If winter comes, can spring be far behind? That's the final line of a 19th century poem called Ode to the West Wind, written by Romantic poet Percy Shelley. He refers to the cyclical nature of seasons. It is a yearning and optimistic closing to a poem about death and rebirth as reflected in the natural world. But the natural world reflects us, too. And in the years since this poem was published, we've made our rapidly warming world, in the words of one climate scientist, a minefield. So while we can share in Percy Shelley's hopeful spirit, he's right to end the poem on an open question. In the winter of our ongoing climate crisis, spring is far behind, is it not? We are living in times where hope is hard to come by. So I must add my own question to the mix. How do we move into a future that ensures the survival of humanity for millennia to come? The start to an answer lies, I think, in a fundamental mindset shift. We often see ourselves as doomed by companies and governments that talk around in circles instead of taking action, making us think that our future in relation to the climate crisis is hopeless and that we will stand by until it is too late. But maybe Percy Shelley was onto something. Maybe there is light at the end of the tunnel. The first step of this mindset shift is realizing our current dependency on an imagined idea of the past. There is a phenomenon called shifting baseline syndrome, a term coined by marine biologist Daniel Pauly in 1995. Due to our short lifespans, humans cannot fully comprehend the extremity of environmental deterioration. Each new generation grows up with a degraded baseline with which they compare any changes they experience in their lifetimes. So what we view as relatively normal environmental conditions, our ancestors would view as a catastrophe. Here are some examples. Nova Scotian sailors only had to drop baskets into the water to haul up cod. Cuban sailors used to note so many turtles that they seemingly covered the sea. And travelers used to note whales so vast in number that they were seemingly infinite. This type of abundance is both astonishing and unimaginable to us now, even though we don't think of our current climate conditions as something completely out of the ordinary. This gradual loss of touch with the healthy conditions of the state of our environment impedes attempts to rally global population around issues such as climate change, as some of the most severe environmental changes do not occur over a matter of years, but decades, spanning the lengths of countless generations. It is only when we look back that we can fully comprehend the impending catastrophe. And once we do recognize the severity of our conditions, we are often paralyzed by fear into inaction, thinking that it's too late to solve our situation. But as Percy Shelley once wrote, there is light at the end of the tunnel. To solve the climate crisis, instead of relying on our past to predict our doom, we should mine it for solutions, and with them, hope. Just look at the new inventions around us today. The same compressed air networks popular in the Victorian era, where air was electrically stored underground for later use, are now being harnessed and readapted as low-cost, small-scale, sustainable energy storage systems that might one day replace batteries. The Dutch used to dredge their lands by hand, supplemented by animal, tidal, and wind power. Current dredging occurs with the use of oil-powered ships that burn up to 1,000 liters of oil an hour. And while a complete return to these traditional methods is unrealistic, their incorporation would lead to a more sustainable process. It brings to mind a famous quote by William Gibson, leader of the cyberpunk movement of the 80s and 90s, who once said, "The future is already here. It's just not very evenly distributed." In other words, the technology of our future can be found in our past, which incidentally has been present this whole time. We can also rely on past predictions for what our world and technologies will look like in the future, which can be found in science fiction and speculative fiction. Works in these genres have coined terms and theorized concepts that have later become fundamental real-world technologies. An example of this can be found in 1935, when author Stanley G. Weinbaum wrote about a device vaguely reminiscent of a gas mask that transports the user into a pre-recorded vision, similar to virtual reality as we experience it today. And these ideas from science fiction are not only theoretical, as many think, but can be and are being applied today. An example of this can be found in The Diamond Age, written by author Neal Stephenson, who envisioned Source Victoria, a molecular disassembly line that slowly purifies air and water while retaining the pollutants elsewhere to be reused. 3F, a Canadian sustainable waste management company, uses this same technology to extract useful materials from waste. So finally, A common Western mindset is to always look forward, towards the next new invention and piece of cutting-edge technology. What we fail to realize is that a world that values this type of progress over ideas from the past might eventually lead to our downfall. We need to fundamentally rethink our idea of the future. It might not contain sleek robots, but instead be a hodgepodge of 1910, 1950, 2020, and all the years in between. So let's not only call for a technological revolution, but for a cultural one. And maybe 100 years from now, instead of sitting on the precipice of a burning planet and creating the next generation of electric cars, we'll be back on horseback. Thank you.